Dwelling in Beulah Land. Saved, you understand that power in the blood of Jesus Christ. If you got saved, boy, it's a great life to live. And we can be thankful about the blood and we can sing about the blood. There is power in the blood.
Power, power, wonder. Turn around, you that are here, look back that direction up in the front. Look at that crowd this morning. That's a good crowd. Good crowd. Now those are all Jehovah's Witnesses that are sitting way back there, and Mormons. They're all sitting in the back row this morning. But amen. Listen, I want you to turn around and shake hands with somebody and say, I'm glad I'm saved. Just do that.
It's like 64 powers or something we add into the chorus, I think. But no, we'll tone it down just a little bit. We'll go 4 powers, all right? There's power, 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 wonder-working power. There's a lot of power in that blood. We couldn't sing it enough. So let's go ahead and sing verse number 4. We're putting 4 powers in on the chorus. Diction, let's go with, that means to pronounce your words, get those lips to actually move this morning. All right, and let's go 8 powers. It was a big step up for you, so let's try it again. All right, so on that chorus. There it is.
I hope and pray that I'm always led by the Spirit, but there's no guarantee. Sometimes flesh may take over once in a while. Amen. Amen. Very thankful for being here and very thankful for being a part of this. And I'm so thankful that there are some great men out here that are still willing to stand upon what thus saith the Lord and not move to the left or the right, but to stay upon the things of God. Ever so blessed, you know, that there again, our youth leader for years wanted me to come to this Chili Baptist organization type thing, you know. Remember, I don't read or write that best, and I thought Chili. And I really still can't pronounce it. It's Chai Lai, right? Is that? Amen. Amen. I think you ought to give me a round of applause for that, you know, that I finally got that. I'm not even sure even how to pray this morning. We were blessed with a man that him and his wife have been coming to our church now for about a year. 17 years in a... I want to be careful, I guess.
Tell the truth.
Okay. I just told him that, hang on when you meet Tony Shirley and Eddie Wyatt. You ain't going to believe what you're going to hear coming out of their lips. But 17 years tied in a charismatic Pentecostal type church. Saw so much of the theatrical stuff. That's a big word for me. Man, just learned that. I heard somebody else say it yesterday. I'm impressed. And and the hooplas and all this. And for the first time ever, he actually experienced what the power of God's all about. And it's not imitation. It was real last night. The problem is he was camped in my hotel room, not willing to sleep. If my eyes look like they're bloodshot, it's not because I went back to drinking. How do you tell a man 52 years old and you know, to shut up, I want to get to sleep, when he's just being... He was a sponge, a dried sponge, just thrown into a big lake, and he just can't get enough. He said, does it have to... end today?
Amen.
And I said, no, listen, you're going back to our church. And he said, right, does it have to end today? We're being blessed with a young lady coming from Pastor Dewey's church. Waited a whole bunch of years to keep herself for a man in our church who's kept himself for 36 years waiting for that right person to come along. And we're 100 miles apart from Pastor Dewey's church and ours. And Pastor Dewey said, I'm not giving her up unless you give something up in return. So we've been bartering back and forth. I'm sending four men that I've been trying to get out of our church. And Brother Bryce has just come out of that charismatic type malarkey. He's going to Dewey's church also. Amen. You'll take anybody. You took Brother Kirk. Amen. Amen. But if you hadn't been blessed, the problem with our youth leader is that when we get back to the hotel, we have to have a conference call with all our youth and adults in one room. And we're tired. But you know, and this is how I'm going to pray this morning. I see it so many times in our youth meetings. I've even seen it here in our own people. We're on this mountaintop experience. And we're going to come down and we're going to go back into that valley. And there's a lot of thicket and briar bushes and blackberry bushes, and we're going to get beat up and torn up and ripped apart. And some of us are going to give up. Some of us are going to quit. Some of us are going to lose that. The spirit that's within us Thursday and Friday, as far as that joy and happiness, contentment. And that's my biggest fear with our people. That it doesn't take very long. And as I shared with Brother Bryce, Do we really think that being filled and blessed the way we have been, that do you think that the devil's going to sit next to the pool with his margarita? That's a drink for some that don't know. And somebody putting the sun lotion on him with his feet up in the air and thinking that we're going to continue enjoying the fullness of what God has for us? Do we really think? I preached a message years ago, then cometh the devil. And he's going to work overtime. But don't forget, he's seeking whom he may devour. He can't devour any of us unless we give in. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 26, he said, watch and pray that you don't fall into temptation. The spirit's willing, but the flesh is ever so weak. And so when we leave here today, after being blessed so much, remember, I love that family that sang last night. I ain't gonna try to pronounce their name, but that's my God. And when you leave here today, don't forget, that's my God. Greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. Remember, if God be for us, who can be against us? We've already won. We've already won. You hang on those things that are of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ. I've been blessed, have you? I have been so blessed, so blessed. Let's bow our hearts and our heads here this morning. Heavenly Father, it's been so good. I can't even begin to express how great my God really is this morning, but you sure are great. Our Heavenly Father, you've been so good to each and every one of us here this day. Lord, we just pray this morning that the power of that blood that saved this old wicked sinner here this morning will be that power of that blood that we pray that each one of us will allow to continue giving us the victories after victories after victories. You said, thanks be to God because we can have those victories because of Jesus Christ. Lord, we have to also remember that we can't have victories if we don't go through some battles. But you told us to stand and withstand against the wiles of the devil. And Lord, my heart desire for each and every one of us, and especially me, we know the adversary isn't going to sit next to that pool. We also know that he isn't going to just sit still and easy because so many surrendered their lives and accepted you into their heart to be their Savior. There's a lot of us here today that are looking for more and more, and it's there and available, but it takes some work on our end. So Lord, we just pray here today that you taught us to trust you with all our heart and not to lean upon our own understanding. And so my prayer here today for every one of us, that we would trust you more today than we ever have before. And we would no longer lean upon what I think or what I want, but that we would look into your word and stick upon what thus saith the Lord. Heavenly Father, I'm just so thankful that I can stand here to say that you're my God. So Lord, we pray for those that are preaching, teaching, singing, sharing, and laughing. That we walk out of here as onward Christian soldiers, and that we would see hell's foundations quiver like never before, because we have seen the power and the glory of God for many of us like never before these last few days. So Lord, we just pray a blessing upon each one. We pray that our hearts and our minds would ever be so attentive to the preaching of your word here this day, that our faith would increase because Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. And Lord, we just pray that as real as you've been this weekend, in each and every one of our lives, you will remain not only just real, but even realer than ever before. Lord, we pray a blessing upon those that are preaching, and Pastor Tony and Pastor Eddie as they're heading back. Be over them and watch over them. Be with their family. Lord, we pray there again a special blessing upon Pastor Eddie. Lord, we pray for his daughter and the husband. Lord, sometimes we don't get what we want all the time. And sometimes we don't understand, but that's why you said your ways are higher and your thoughts are greater, more than what we could even begin to comprehend. But I'm thankful this morning that the Wyatt family may not have the privilege of enjoying their daughter, that child or that grandchild here on earth, but we know one day in heaven that family will be reunited. So Lord, a special blessing upon them. Just comfort them and undergird them with your love like never before. Lord, we're very thankful for Pastor Hal and all those that fasted and prayed over every seat that's here today. Without a lot of us even knowing it, you're sitting in a seat that's been prayed well over. We're walking on and we're sitting on holy ground here this morning because we had some faithful sisters and brothers that wanted to see the power of God move over here this weekend, and we're so thankful it did. So Lord, we just pray for the moving here this morning, the power of you just being all over us. If there's still any heart here this morning that ain't got right with you, Lord, we just pray they would. And Lord, if there's somebody here this morning that has not yet trusted you as their Lord and Savior of their life, Lord, before we even continue, just pray so hard that that person will lean over to that one next to them and say, you know what? I'm missing out on something, and I want what they got. So, Lord, thank you so much for being our God, our Savior, and thank you so much for all that you've given us in the last whole bunch of hours. We just love you, and we thank you, and we ask this now all in your precious name. Amen and amen.
I appreciate this. My first time being here at Youth Ablaze, and never heard anything bad about this meeting, but the half was not told. And it's tremendous, and I appreciate the opportunity. I'm burdened this morning about this. It's been preached on already. And, you know, as an evangelist, that's our heartbeat, is the church, obviously. But I appreciate Brother Eddie's message on Thursday night, and I appreciate what Brother Jesse preached last night. But I want to preach to you this morning for just a few minutes on the most important question that could ever be asked. In Acts chapter 16, verse number 29, we know Paul and Silas are in prison. At midnight, they're singing and praising God, and there was a jailer that got under conviction when he saw that. And he said in verse 29, he says, "Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved?'" Father, help us for just a few minutes, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. As I said, this is the most important question that anybody could ever ask. And if it's the most important question that could be asked, then the answer is obviously very important as well. And we need to think about that answer. We need to analyze the answer to that question. You say, well, what's the big deal about the answer? Well, because what Paul did give for an answer is just as important as what he did not give for an answer. What he did tell them, what he did say to them, is just as important as what he didn't say to them. And can I say, down through the ages, millions, yea, probably billions of people have asked that very same question that this jailer asked Paul and Silas. What must I do to be saved? I was getting my hair cut the other day, and always go to a barber shop, but we're out there in the out in the sticks, and there was no barber shop around. There was a couple of ladies that cut hair. He said, well, you went to a lady to get their hair cut? Well, I did that time, but I found out it was a divine appointment. Amen. I was sitting there. I was the only one there. And she asked me where I was from and what I was doing. I told her I was a preacher. She said, I got some questions for you. It only took her about 20 minutes to cut my hair, but it took another hour after that with not one more customer coming in. And her asking almost this very question. Not exactly in those terms, but she grew up confused and she grew up told this and that and the other, what she had to do, like Brother Eddie preached the other night. It's not what you do, it's what's already been done. And I'm not trying to copy Brother Eddie. I'm just saying that I've already had the thoughts in my mind and my heart. In a crowd this size, I guarantee you, even though some have left and gone home and some of them are already probably back at home, already, there's still some here this morning. You're still in this place wondering that very same thing still today. What must I do to be saved? And Paul, ever so gently, he gives the question. The question has been asked of religious leaders. It's been asked of pastors and missionaries and evangelists and youth leaders and all of that. And can I say that down through the years, how many times that question has been answered with eternally damnable results and responses to that question. They've been told that you have to be good. They've been told you have to do good. They've been told you have to keep the commandments, get baptized, join a church, something like that. They've even been told if you just pray a prayer, ask Jesus into your heart, all of that. But listen, I'm going to tell you, it is exactly the answer that Paul gave that is the real answer to that question. And we have been infiltrated in our churches today with a false gospel of doing this and doing that. But what Paul did is he looked at him in the eyes and he said this, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. What's it mean to believe? It means to trust in. Boy, I was coming out of the chair last night when Brother Jesse was preaching. And there are people that said, Lord, if I'm not saved, save me. And he said, if you're still praying that prayer, it's because you have never, ever trusted in Jesus Christ. Amen. To believe means to trust in, to rely on, to rest in, to have confidence in. Can I tell you here this morning, teenager, adult, does not matter. There is one in heaven who you can have all the confidence in the world. He's not going to lie to you. He's not going to turn you astray. You can trust him tonight, this morning. You can put your faith in him. You can rest in him for your very eternity. Yeah. Yeah. Acts chapter 8, the Ethiopian eunuch. He was going along with Philip and he said, see, here's water. What to hinder me to be baptized? What was the Ethiopian eunuch told to do? He said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. John 3:16, the most famous verse in the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever what? Believeth in him. Not say anything, do anything, go anywhere. All these motions that we get used to doing. No, he said, if you believe, thou mayest. Believe with all thine heart. Jesus himself said, and this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life. Trusting in what? Believing in what? Him. Resting in what? Him. What Jesus Christ did on the cross. Hey, it was my sin that put him there. It was your sin that put him there. And because of what he did at Calvary, and because I can trust in that, I don't have to worry. I don't have to fear. He is that hiding place that we've been hearing such good preaching about and singing about this week. Listen, can I tell you, he's our hiding place in this world. He's our hiding place through the storms of life. But hey, the greatest thing that we'll ever face, our eternity, he's our eternal hiding place this morning. He's that rock that we can cling to. He's that hope that we have. He's that thing that we are trusting in for our very eternity. Let me ask you a question here this morning. Teenager, adult, young person, are you saved? Not the one next to you. Not the one in front of you or behind you. I'm talking about you this morning. Are you saved? I mean, if there's any kind of doubt or anything like that, you better get it taken care of. Preacher that opened in prayer. It'd be good for you just to get it settled this morning. Amen. There's no guarantee of tomorrow. How many young people we've heard down through the years, young people aren't thinking of death. Amen. That's not their mindset, most of them. Long life ahead of them, I'll do it later, all of that. Well, let's say you're banking on that, and that maybe that's so. There's a thing in the Bible called the rapture. Amen. And Jesus could come back before we end this service this morning. Where would you go if that would take place? If you say, yes, Brother Craig, I know, I'm saved this morning. Let me ask you how you know that. What's your answer if somebody were to say, why did you say yes? If your answer is anything or anybody other than Christ, amen. You need to get it settled this morning. Amen. If you're looking back at something you have done, something you were told to do, if your answer is anything other than Christ, put your trust in him this morning. You think going to a youth meeting and there's so many topics to preach on. When Brother Roscoe talked to me back in June and asked me to preach for a little bit, I immediately started praying, and this was my heart and my burden since June. We can pray, and listen, we need to send our young people back to their churches excited and on fire for God. Amen. But we need to send some new Christians back to their churches. Amen. On fire for God. Thank God for every soul that's been saved here this week. Thank God for it. But like the preacher said this morning, I'm not convinced that everybody in here is saved this morning. And you know, there's the mental gymnastics that you go through as a preacher. You can plan on preaching on salvation. First message out of the bag, Thursday night, salvation. Brother Jesse preached on it last night. It's been preached on some others. I went back to the room last night and I got on my face before God and I said, Lord, is it still the message? And he said, I told you what to preach. Amen. Young person, teenager, adult. It'd be good to see some adults get saved. Amen. I was preaching a meeting last week, and the last night of the meeting, Friday night, the piano player's wife got saved after the service. She said, for 32 years, I had a relationship with the church. She said, for 32 years, I had a relationship with the church people. I had a relationship with the ministry. I had a relationship with people. But she said, I never had a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we got people in our, we have become, and don't take this wrong, but we have become Catholic in our thinking. We have so many people, and even some here today, you are relying on all the things you have done. I must be saved. I'm serving God. I must be saved. I'm going to church. I must be saved. I'm involved in a bus ministry. I must be saved. I'm doing it. That has nothing to do with it, young person. Again, if your answer is not Christ on why you're going to heaven, then I would encourage you to get it settled this morning. This sounds like a weird question, but I'll back it up with Scripture. Who says you're saved? You say, Brother Craig, I'm saved. Who says you're saved? The Bible says that the Spirit beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. When that question is asked, if you're here this morning and you know for a fact you're saved, and would you raise your hand? If there ain't something itching inside of you, raising your hands almost for you, the Holy Ghost of God that is speaking for you. I'm going to tell you right now, I'd encourage you to come and get it settled this morning. Get so far in, get so saved, amen, that nobody can talk you out of it. If you can be talked out of it, you probably never had it. It has to be Christ. There's no doubt about it. Listen, biblical salvation is not confusing. You want to know why people are confused today about it? Because of the devil. Because man has confused it. But Christ is very clear. Over 400 references in the New Testament alone, direct references to faith and believing and trusting in Christ. Amen. You want to know why I'm saved here this morning? Because of him. Because of him, not me. And so I just want to encourage you this morning, for those of you that have been holding out. There are some who are holding out because they don't think they could live up to some standard or something like that. But there's some who are, they're not really technically holding out. They're just confused about it. There needs to be no confusion. What must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Father, I pray, God, that you would take this thought from the Word of God. And Lord, I pray that you'd work on hearts. Lord, there's probably no doubt in a crowd this size, some that have been under conviction since the first service. God, for those, Lord, that are still wondering, still wavering, I pray, God, you'd take away their confusion and give them confidence today in Jesus Christ and have them put their faith and trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus told his disciples of things to persecuted, beaten and mocked. The Son of Man would die on the cross, but he wouldn't stay dead, and he won't stay gone. He didn't stay dead, and he won't stay gone. Like a thief in the night, with the trump of God, the King of all kings, who paid the cost, didn't stay dead, and he won't stay gone. He didn't stay dead, and he won't stay gone.
She's all alone up in her room with a razor in her hand. Daddy's gone and Mama's ill. She just doesn't understand. God, why do this thing to me? You left me all alone. I'm torn and broken pieces. Where's the love you said atones? Then she heard him say, I've never loved you at all. I've been standing by your side, even though you felt all alone. I wiped your tear that you cried. I feel the pain you feel, bore the burden you bear. So when you feel all alone, my child, know that I'm right there. He knows just how to play the game, acting hard as stone, drugs with friends and having fun, but inside he feels alone. You see, he misses Mommy dear. He was her precious little boy. She's not here to wipe his tears. Where's the God she loved the most? Then he heard him say, I've never loved you at all. I've been standing by your side, even though you felt all alone. I wiped your tear that you cried. I feel the pain you feel, bore the burden you bear. So when you feel all alone, my child, know that I'm right there. He's never left you at all. He's still standing by your side. Even when you feel all alone, he'll wipe each tear that you cry. He feels the pain you feel, he'll take those burdens you bear. So when you feel all alone, his child, know that he's right there.
Alright. Today I got a pair of glasses. As you can see, they're quite nice. You know, I got my funny glasses on. Can barely wear them.
Turn the nose.
Yep. See? Yep. Yep. This is me. Yeah.
I gotta leave them on.
Oh, I gotta leave them on. Okay. Okay. Yeah, I can barely see right now, guys, but a lot of times we as, you know, like a lot of youth and stuff, whatever, they don't have always the right reasons and motives to go into a youth group and whatever. Sometimes, you know, they're just there for the friends and who knows, whatever kind of gains they can get for themselves and within their churches and whatnot, without having a true relationship with Jesus Christ, which is the whole thing. I mean, sure, it's nice to have friends and everything, but if you're doing it for other people, then you're not really doing it for the right reasons. And so, just make sure that you do whatever you do. The Bible says in Colossians, for whatsoever you do, do it heartily unto the Lord and not unto men. So that's the biggest thing that is, you as youth and whatnot, when you go back home, you don't try to act super spiritual for your friends or for whatever, you know. do it for your relationship with the Lord. And because if you do it for other people, then it's not going to last very long. Because it's not real. So you better make sure that you're real and that you're not some fake Christian. Yeah, because then you're just going to flake out on everybody else. And it's not going to be real at all. And that's the biggest thing to do is just to make sure you're real.
Amen. That's good. Yeah. Don't mask your Christianity. Amen. Yeah. Okay, we got another one. Let's go.
I got a mirror today. And I just thought of the how people look at themselves. And, in the bathroom and everything, I always think of girls, how they put on their makeup and everything. And it sort of brought me to Ecclesiastes 10:1. Dead flies cause the ointment of the apothecary to send forth a stinking savor. So doth little folly him that is in reputation for wisdom and honor. You know, tonight, are you putting on the ointment of the apothecary with all the flies of the world? You know, the only thing you really should be putting on is the blood of Jesus Christ and really relying on him. And just, I'd challenge every one of us today to really examine yourself in that mirror and say, what am I looking at? Am I looking at a reflection of Jesus Christ?
I got a pillow. When I look at this pillow, it kind of reminds me of how God, you can use God as your pillow. As in the song, Fishers of Men, he says that he will give you rest if you go to Christ. When you accept God as your Lord and Savior, you feel at rest. You can sleep better. So when you look at the pillow, don't look at it just as a pillow. This is God putting your sins at rest in hell, that you'll never have to deal with them again. Once you give them to God, you can rest easier now that you've accepted him and you've done with them. You're done.
There you go. Thank you. Woe to them that are at ease at Zion. Amen. Okay, let's go.
Well, I got an umbrella. And when I see the umbrella, it made me think of Colossians 3:3. He will hide you under his umbrella. The umbrella, obviously the objective is to stop the rain, snow, whatever comes at you in your life. But Jesus Christ, what he is trying to do, he's trying to shield you. There will be bad times, but he will stop some things in your life. He will let some things happen, but not everything that comes your way is 100% bad, because you have Jesus Christ there to block all the sin and evil in the world.
There's a story in the Bible about a city God had prepared for a man that he could run to when he found himself in trouble, in times of great despair, running from the one who sought his life. And there outside the city, he would cry to the keeper and ask if he could enter in. And there he would find shelter. You see, God had made provision, a city of refuge for him. And one day I ran to the city of refuge. So guilty I was, but I found shelter in the blood that he shed for me. I was condemned, oh, but God showed me mercy. man on Calvary. My God built a city of refuge for me. Condemned by the fall of man, I was bound in sin with a debt to be paid. Oh, but Jesus, He cared for me, and on Mount Calvary a foundation was laid. And then God, He stretched out His hand, a mighty gulf did span, just to set my soul free. And now I can run to God's only Son, a city of refuge for me. And one day I ran to the city of refuge. So guilty I was, I found shelter in the blood that He shed for me. And I was condemned, oh, but God showed me mercy. And on Calvary, my God built a city of refuge for me. And on Calvary, my God built a city of refuge for me. James chapter 4, here we're going to read a verse. I want to give you a simple challenge this morning. Brother Art's prayer at the beginning kind of confirmed for me the way I felt like the Lord was leading me this morning. And so I trust that the Lord's going to help us right here before we leave. I want to say I appreciate Brother Hal letting me come back and the church. Church, I appreciate you putting on this meeting. I know the other churches assist and help as well, but everybody that helps to put this meeting on, it is such an encouragement to me to come. And I've got a couple of meetings in the next few weeks. I go to another youth meeting in 2 weeks. Next week, I'll be in Philadelphia at Brother Burton Gates Church Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night, and fly home Sunday morning and go to our church. And so the week after that, I'll be in Brother Jenkins' youth meeting. And it just stirs my heart to get together and see this many young people that still like the old-time way, still like the old preaching and the old singing. And I praise the Lord for that. It stirs my heart. It gives you hope for America. You say, oh, no, America's going down. Well, there's still a remnant that love God, and I thank the Lord for that. I pray all the time. I say, Lord, be merciful to our country for the remnant's sake. And I thank God there is a remnant. And I praise the Lord for you young people that give us hope that you love God and you want to serve God. And I understand that in all of our groups like this, there's always some that are not what they seem to be. They're like the brother that just had the little mask on. I realize that. You know what else you need to realize, adults? You need to realize that some of the young people are real. And some of them are sincere. And some of them do love God. And some of them are going to do the best they can. And some of them are going to do better than we've ever done by far. And that ought to stir your heart a little bit about wanting to keep doing this and keep having youth meetings and keep working with young people. And so I praise the Lord for being here. Thank you for every prayer. They were talking about, somebody talked about earlier, the praying and the fasting over the chairs and the seats. And you know, you need to realize something, that the power of God that has been here in these services is because of that. It's not because of Brother Eddie. It's not because of me. It's not because of the people that are, you know, just come in and get in on the meeting. It's all the preparatory spiritual warfare that has been taking place in this church and the other churches that do that. And so I praise the Lord for that. I thank the Lord for it. And I promise you this, I realize that it is you. It is you that has brought the goods in this meeting. It certainly is not me. I'm just thankful to get in on it. And so praise the Lord for that and thank God for it. It's a life-changing meeting. And my life has changed, particularly yesterday, as the preacher organized it for me to get in touch with my feminine side yesterday. And I had to go eat. By the way, the eating lunch with all the ladies was about as strange as standing and speaking to all the ladies. I walked up there and I got in there and I'm looking around. It's all ladies. And then I thought, well, I got to get in line. And they all start looking at me like, what are you doing here? I started feeling it. You know, you can feel it. Finally, I just said, I was told to be here. And one girl said, I thought it was girls. I said, it is. I'm not one. I was told to be here. I just kept saying, I was told to be here. I'm supposed to be here. And finally, I found Brother John, is it? Or
Bob, John, all the same. Anyway, found Brother Bob over there, and he was working, taking up money or whatever it was he was doing. And I said, can I sit with you? Praise God. He is the only man in the place that I could find. And so I sat with him and then kind of spared myself from that pain that was going through. But then I came in here and spoke to the ladies. I did like that. I enjoyed that. I figured out that girls might be a little smarter than boys. Teenage girls, teenage boys in particular. Now, when we get older, we far surpass you ladies. But the teenage boys are not too smart, are they? Come on now. I heard about one recently, and he lived out way out in the middle of nowhere. They didn't have running water. It had an outhouse. I don't know if some of you even know what an outhouse is, but it's not a really great thing. I mean, if you don't have anything else, it's pretty handy, but if you can get something else, it's not really wonderful. It's really cold when the winter time comes and stinks all the time. And that's the way that boy got to feeling. He said, I hate this thing. And he tried to hatch a plan to get rid of it so they'd be forced to do something else. So one day it had come really bad rain and the river had come up high. And he thought, man, this is it. I'm going to push this thing in the river and get rid of it. And mom and dad will have to do something else. So he sure enough, he starts getting a stick and lodging it under there and prying it loose and starts sliding that. Pretty soon it fell over in the river and washed away. And he went ahead and thought, okay, I did it. That night his daddy called him in the room and said, son, I need to talk to you. And he could tell he could tell his dad was mad, and dad started looking at him, and he said, I believe you probably know what you're in here for. And he said, you pushed the outhouse in the river today, didn't you? That boy thought about it for a minute, and kind of knew, obviously dad had figured it out. He said, yeah. And he said, yes, sir, I did. He said, you know, dad, I was just studying in school, and they said that George Washington cut down a cherry tree or something he wasn't supposed to do, and said when he told the truth, he didn't get in trouble. That daddy looked at him and said, George Washington's daddy wasn't in that cherry tree. When you push your daddy in the outhouse in the river, you're going to get a beating that night. That's all I can tell you. Girls wouldn't have done that. Boys just not too smart. Amen. All right, James chapter 4, verse 7. Glory to God. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Say the next three words with me. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Let's just read the whole verse again together. Begin. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. We're just going to stay in this one verse. I'm going to give you just a couple of minutes here of a challenge, and then I'll be stepping out. So let's pray together. Father, thank you for the privilege to be in this meeting. I don't just say that. Lord, what a blessing this meeting is to my heart every year. I am encouraged by the Spirit of God that's here. I'm encouraged by the congregations that come, all these churches that bond together during this week. And Lord, I know that there are some differences, minor ones. I know that there's probably conflicts from time to time, but I sure do appreciate the example that they are of coming together for the good of Christ and for the good of these young people. And Lord, I appreciate that. And I know that's one of the reasons you bless the meeting, because you like unity, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. And Lord, these churches do that every year at this meeting, and you are so kind to manifest. And as somebody said, magnify your presence like you did last night. But Lord, as Brother Art prayed today, this isn't the end of it. We go home, and Lord, as soon as we go back home, the spiritual war will magnify in our lives. There will be the counterattack that will always come. And I pray that you'd help me say something now that would be a blessing to them when they get back, particularly these young people, and have to face what is coming spiritually. Lord, you'd give them these thoughts that they might remember this and Lord, be able to withstand when those temptations come. We'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, I guess if I was going to give it a title this morning from this verse, I'd like to give you some thoughts on this topic, the great resistance, a great resistance. Now, when you leave a meeting like this where the presence of God has been so powerful, I probably say it every year, I'm going to say it again. God never comes in a service like he did last night and like he has multiple times in your churches. He never does that just so we can feel good. It's never just so that we can get warm and fuzzy. And, you know, people will say, boy, the hair stood up on the back of my neck and boy, that felt so good. Now, I'm not against the feeling good. I believe in feeling. I'm thankful we got something we can feel, and I praise the Lord for that. Now, you can tell, obviously, I like rejoicing. I like shouting. I think that we probably ought to do it more. I don't think rejoicing the Lord always. I doubt that we're ahead of the I doubt we're ahead of the curve in what he deserves from our praise and worship, if you will. As a matter of fact, probably the charismatics in that phrase, praise and worship, being abused has caused some of us to go away from it because we don't want anybody to accuse us of being that, and so we're even further behind. So I appreciate all that, but listen, when God comes in a service like that, that is not the sole purpose for his presence, not just so we can feel good and say what a great service it was. There is always some end result. There is always some lasting difference that he wants it to make in our hearts and in our lives and then in our youth groups and then in our churches. He wants it to do something that will be lasting and bear fruit in our lives. And so when you've been in a meeting like that, like this weekend, you will experience when you get home some spiritual counterattacks. Brother Art painted a very clear picture in our mind. The devil is not laying by the pool with his feet up thinking, well, I lost that round. I lost all those young people, so I'm just going to take a few days off. Oh, no. No, no. He is planning and plotting right now as to how he will try, like a boxer in a boxing match. This weekend, the Holy Spirit has helped us to throw some punches and land some punches for the cause of Christ. Well, what happens is a good boxer, and by the way, the devil is good at his job, is you take them, but then you send one right back. You counter punch, you counter attack, and those are going to come. They're going to come in all of our lives. The spiritual counter attacks are coming when we get back. And, you know, in this world, it's everywhere. And in these last days, more and more, there are things coming after the hearts and minds of our young people. Our senses are daily bombarded with wickedness and sensuality and sin. And it's unbelievable. The commercials are really unbelievable of what they will use to try and sell any product. It doesn't matter now what they're selling. They want to use sensuality and sin to sell it. They could be selling camel saddles, all right? Saddles for two hump camels, if there is such a thing. And it would be a near naked woman on there selling it. Now, let me just say, nobody rides a camel naked. But nobody eats a chocolate bar in a, you know, in a formal gown that's split all the way up to here. But that's who's selling it on the commercial, because that sensuality is what they're using to come after us. And so when we go back to our lives, and young people, when you go back to your life, it's going to be everywhere. And the devil's going to take you and point you at it, and he's going to bring it into your life, and this wicked world is going to make sure that it's there. And so even now, not only in the world, but our own spirituality is sometimes bombarded with, as I talked a little bit yesterday, of carnality and compromise and the contemporary worship scene and all those things. So it's becoming more important than ever that we have some Christians, especially young people, who will resist, who will learn to resist the things that are not good for us. And when you get back from this meeting, you're going to have to resist the spiritual counterattack that is coming. Submit yourselves to God. Resist the devil. Let me point out in this verse just a couple of things, and then I will share an illustration with you at the end and show you the power of resisting, what it can do in your life and what it can do for others. First of all, I see in this verse an identification. There must be an identification of the two sides. If you look in the verse, submit yourselves therefore to, say it. Everybody say it. Submit yourselves therefore to. Resist the, well, there's your two sides. You must, as young people, be able to identify and realize that there are two sides, and you got to figure out which sides you're on. Now, there's been much preaching about it, and I praise the Lord for it, but the way you get on the Lord's side is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. You must be born again. That's how you get on the Lord's side. Young people, you need to understand that there are two sides. There is, obviously, all weekend we've been rejoicing in that we have a true and a living God that you can run to that is real. And listen, you need to understand, we thank God for that. But if God's real, there's also a devil and he's real. There's also devils and they're real. And there's a real spirit in this world that hates Lord Jesus Christ and hates what's going on in our lives. And so there must be an identification that there are two sides, and you need to make a choice as to which side you're going to get on. So then not only an identification, but then there's a decision. The decision is submit yourselves. Brother Charlie preached yesterday about humble yourselves. He kept saying it's a choice, as is this. Submitting yourselves to God. Deciding there's God, there's the devil. I'm choosing the Lord's side. I'm going to submit myself to the Lord. Now, listen, that doesn't happen by accident, young people. And by the way, that doesn't happen just because you've enjoyed the meeting. It doesn't happen just because you came to the altar, which we thank God for it. Many times in youth meetings, what happens is that you come down and you make spiritual decisions, but then you need to go back and make the physical changes that go with that spiritual decision. Well, Lord, I want to try to do a little better. I want to get closer to you. I want to learn more about you. Well, listen, if you want to learn more about him, then there's some things you could do physically in life. You could read the Bible more. You could pray more. You could go to church more. And so it doesn't do anything for you to come all day and say, I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. If you don't go back to your life and put some physical things in place to help know you more. And so the submission here is a choice that you're going to go back and say, I don't want to just say we had a good youth meeting and I can't wait till the next one, but I want to be different this time. I want it to last this time. I want to be a different Christian this time when I go back to school and all those things. So it's a decision to submit yourself. It's not an accident. It's not something your parents can do. It's not something the preachers can do or even your peers can do for you. It is something you must decide that you want to be on the Lord's side. And listen, a step further than that, not just I want to be saved, but I want to be the Lord's servant. I want to submit to him. I want to follow him, walk with him. And identification, there's two sides, God and the devil. I'm going quickly. A decision, submit yourselves. Then an action comes after that. You decide, I'm going to submit myself to the Lord. I want to be a servant of the Lord. We already discussed there's going to be counterattacks that come. And so then there must be an action to go with that decision. And that is, all right, if I'm going to be a servant of the Lord like I should be, I'm going to have to resist the devil. I'm going to have to learn this action of resisting. Just choosing a side isn't enough. Let me say that again. Just choosing a side isn't enough, especially in these last days. In these last days, we need some young people to resist. The word resist means to stand against. Stand against. To say, I don't want that. I don't believe in that. I'm not going to do that. And resist the devil. 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring what? Lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. Now God on purpose used the lion in that illustration so that we would know how powerful and how ferocious our enemy is. A lion weighs as much as 500 pounds and can run up in bursts of 30 miles per hour. That's a fast animal at that size. 500 pound animal running 30 miles an hour in sprints. He can jump to the height and reach with his paw a height as high as 12 feet. A basketball goal is 10 feet. So a lion at 500 pounds can run in sprints of 30 miles an hour. You say, well, I'll just climb a tree. You better climb high. Because he can jump and reach 12 feet. He can jump across a span at that full speed and jump. He can jump across a span of 36 feet. Well, I'll just get across this ravine. It better be a big one. He can jump. 36 feet's a long ways, man. That lion is a powerful, ferocious beast. Their paw strike, just with the slap of their paw, they can knock, a 500-pound tiger, they can knock it flying across the jungle. Ferocious animal, powerful animal. And that's the picture God wants us to have of this enemy that we have, a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. If you've been saved this weekend, he cannot get your soul. Say amen right there. But he can still ruin your life. He can still devour your life. So we must learn to resist the devil. Say them three words. Resist the devil. You know, in that verse there where he says he's a roaring lion, the very next verse says, resist in the faith. And so even though he is unbelievably powerful, I am thankful that if we stay up close to the good shepherd can handle him. And through the help of the good shepherd, you can resist the devil. And so, first of all, there's an identification that there's two sides. And you make that decision that you want to submit yourself to the Lord. I want to choose the Lord. I don't want to just be saved. I want to be a servant of the Lord. I want to be a young person that makes a difference in the world for the cause of Christ. And then comes the other side trying to lure you back away from that decision. So you must learn to resist the devil, where you understand how powerful he is, you understand how strong he is and how smart he is. And so you understand that you don't have the power in yourself to resist the devil, but by faith and asking the Lord to help you, he can help you resist the devil. Then there comes the conclusion. In the verse here it says, and he will flee from you. Now we saw a picture of this in Luke chapter 4 when Satan came and tempted the Lord Jesus himself. Jesus resisted his temptations, most of you know, with the word of God three times, quoting verses. And the Bible said, after he resisted him those three times, it says, Satan, he departed from him for a season. Now that for a season is important, young people, because listen, that means you don't just resist one time and never have to worry about it again. That's why we have so many old folks that fall apart when they get older, because, boy, when they were growing up, they were in church and all they heard was preaching about when they're young. And, boy, they got to be careful and they got to stay away from sin and they can't do this and got to put up these guardrails. And, boy, they did all that. And then they made it through those teen years and made it through them young adult years and maybe even made it through the raising of their children. And now, finally, they've reached that age. And you know what a lot of older folks do? They let down their guard then. They let down that shield of faith. And all of a sudden, me and Brother Dave was talking about last night, all of a sudden they start doing things that they never would do before. You know, after Noah got his family through the flood, here's what it says. It says he began to be a husbandman. Now, that means he had never done it before. That wasn't something he fooled around with before the flood, but now he'd had got his whole family saved. They're all older, they're adults. And Noah let up a little bit, I think. Started fooling around with stuff he never did before. And you know what happened? Helped ruin the life of one of his children. You know, Solomon messed up, but it wasn't when he was young. It was when he was older, and he had all them wives, which, by the way, he wasn't supposed to do. And it says they turned his heart away, and he allowed the worship of false idols. David did great when he was a young boy fighting Goliath. David did great when he was a young man on the run from Saul, behaved himself wisely in all of his ways, and the Lord was with him. David did great when he first became the king, and boy, he ruled and reigned and got all that victory. But when he was older, he messed up. So young people, it's not just you, it's us adults. We must learn to continually resist the devil. Everybody say them three words, resist the devil. And it's something we have to continue to do, and as we're older, it doesn't go away, you gotta keep doing it. The conclusion though is, if we learn to resist and through the help of the Lord we can resist the devil, he will flee from us at least for a season. That you can get victory. Now you'll have to do it again later, but you can get the victory. Young people, when you go back and the counterattack comes, don't just give up at the first battle. Here's what's going to happen to some of you. You came this weekend. You've been living pretty wild lives. Some of you have been living wicked lives. But this weekend, you got right with God. You gave it all to God. And you're going to go back to your life. And guess what's going to happen? If you're not careful, somebody's going to find out something bad you did before you got right. And you're going to get in trouble for it. Amen. And then here's what's going to happen in your heart. Is this what I get for getting right with God? I mean, I got right with God this weekend. I'm trying to live for the Lord, and now I'm going to get in trouble for something I did before. And, oh, if this is what I get for living for the Lord, I don't want no part of it. No, no, no. Hey, recognize it as the spiritual counterattack and understand that we still have to reap and sow sometimes for our actions. And understand this, it's still worth doing it right. And so resist the temptation to give up. Fight through that spiritual counterattack, and he eventually will back off, and you'll get another season of victory. The next season of battle will come. You resist again. The conclusion is you can have some victory in your life, young people. Every young person don't have to get right at the youth meeting and then backslide again. There can be some that'll get right and stay right. And we want some of you to do that. I want you to know that you can make a difference. Listen to me now. I want you to know you can make a difference by resisting the devil. You can make a difference. You can resist the devil and then make a difference in your own life. But listen to this. Your resisting can make a difference in the lives of others. Boy, if Eve had been able to resist, it would have affected some people, wouldn't it? If she'd have been able to resist the devil and that temptation, we'd never have known sin, sorrow, sadness, sickness, or eternal separation of hell. Your resisting makes a difference in your own life, but it also affects the lives around you. You may be thinking, preacher, you just don't know how hard it is now. You're old. And if you're thinking that, shame on you for thinking I'm old. You're thinking, preacher, when you guys grew up, it just wasn't like it is now. And I believe that. I understand that. Sin was not quite so easily accessible as it is now for you. I mean, used to, if you wanted to look at pornography, you had to at least go to the store and embarrass yourself to one person. You at least had to face that person on the other side of the counter and say, I want to go over that room nobody goes to. And at least had to embarrass. Now you don't got to embarrass yourself to nobody. You can do it in the privacy of your own house. You can do it in that bedroom with that phone that your parents let you take in there, which is crazy. Or on that internet they let you have in your bedroom all by yourself, which is crazy. And nobody ever has to know, you think. And so it's so much more easily accessible. And I understand that. And I agree with that. But I also know this, grace is sufficient, the Bible says. And that God will empower you to be able to resist if you want to resist the wickedness in your life. Let me tell you a little story about some Christians that just like you young people, this will be it. An illustration, take a couple minutes and that'll be it. Some young people, or some Christians, excuse me, just like you, that were facing what seemed to be an impossible situation. Their enemy was bigger and stronger and more equipped than they were. The whole world, to be honest with you, thought that that there was no way they could win. But here's what they chose. They didn't choose to resist just so they could win. They just chose to resist. And that's what some of you need to do. Quit worrying about the end result and just choose to resist the devil. Say them words again. Resist the devil. Everybody say it. Resist the devil. Let's do it in three sections. Make sure you're awake. You'll resist the devil. Sorry about that. Here we go. Resist. You say, why are you doing it like that? To keep us awake. I know what time it is. I know what day it is. All right. Resist the devil. Jonas Clark, a name maybe some of you are familiar with, but probably many of you young people are not. Jonas Clark was a pastor of the Congregational Church in Lexington, Massachusetts in the mid to late 1700s. One night, Jonas Clark was having at his home dinner with a couple of other men, the names you might recognize. He was having dinner at his home with John Hancock and Samuel Adams. John Hancock and Samuel Adams are two of the leaders of America's Revolution and two of the greatest patriots of the birth of our nation. The date of this dinner was April the 18th, 1775. You might not know that date, but you'll know that that was the night that a man named Paul Revere took his famous ride on his horse. Brother Eddie, I said horse. Did you get excited? If you say the word horse, Brother Eddie gets excited. Amen. Poco, y'all remember Poco? Yeah, we'll never forget. We have memories of Poco, nightmares of Poco. Did y'all know his great-grandpa on his daddy's side was famous and his great-grandpa on his mama's side was famous? Do y'all know that about Poco? I mean, this is not some shabby horse. We're talking about a champion. There he goes again. God help us. If you think it's bad to listen to this, you ought to try to control it up here, all right? Paul Revere took his famous ride on that horse that night, alerting the colonists that the British are coming. What many of you may not know is that Paul Revere was not just riding aimlessly around town screaming that. That's kind of the picture we have from the way it's been told and the way we've seen it in cartoons or films or whatever. But actually, there were many people that still were against the revolution. And so if he'd been just riding up and down the road screaming that, there would have been those who were still favorable to British rule, if you will, that would have told people about it. So he was actually riding up and down the streets going to specific places, alerting the people that would want to know that the British were coming. One of the stops on his plan that night was the house here of Pastor Jonas Clark, because he also knew what two men were there. And they also had heard that the British were coming, and they had a couple of specific goals in mind, one of which was to kill Adams and Hancock. They understood that if we can kill these two men, it'll help kill the birth of this revolution, and we can probably put a stop to it before it even gets out of hand. And so the British were coming, first of all, to stop in this town, Lexington, in order to get Hancock and Adams and kill them and wipe them out. And then they were going to go to the next town of Concord, because in Concord was a possession, a storehouse of ammunition and gunpowder for the rebels. And so the British were indeed coming, as Paul Revere was telling them, and they were coming to Lexington to get these two men. Then they were going to go on to Concord and try to get their arms, if you will, and their supplies, and try to end this battle really before it ever got started. So Paul Revere comes to the house, and he tells Pastor Clark and Hancock and Adams, and he says, they're on their way. They are coming or coming for you. At that point, these two men, these two patriots, Adams and Hancock, ask Pastor Clark, and here's what they said. Are your people ready? Will the people of Lexington fight? Pastor Clark responded this and what he said. He said, yes, my people are ready. I have been preparing them for just this day. You say, what did he mean by that? Well, what he meant was that he had been preaching in his church about the evils of tyranny and the importance of liberty. By the way, they're both still very true today. Don't take for granted the liberty that we have. Praise the Lord that we can just put up a sign and say, we're going to have church for 3 days and preach about Jesus. And we can still do that in our great country. Young people, there were some Christians involved here that learned to resist. Because they were willing to resist, we enjoy the benefits that we're enjoying today. He had been preaching against the evils of tyranny and about the importance of liberty, and he had told the men of his church that there would come a time that they would have to fight for their freedom. He had also instructed them, listen now, it won't be much longer. He had said, do not fire first. He said, because I believe God would bless a war of defense more than a war of offense. That's what he had thought. So he told him, he said, there may be a day that we literally have to take up arms and stand and fight for these freedoms that I'm preaching to you about. And when that day comes, he said, don't fire the first shot, because we want God's help. And he said, I believe God would more bless a defense, in other words, a defending yourself, than he would an offensive attack. So that was the way he was teaching his men. And so he begins to preach, and he began to teach and was telling them these things. And it was the church bell of Jonas Clark's church that rang out that night and rallied just over 100 men from their town, most of which were deacons and members of Pastor Clark's church. Paul Revere comes riding through. He begins to tell certain people the British are coming. He tells Hancock and Adams, and they quiz this pastor and say, are your people willing and are they ready? He says, yes. So they begin to sound the alarm, which is the church bell. They're ringing the church bell, and the men of the town have been hearing the preaching. They know what it means, and the men of this congregation begin to pour out, and there was just around 100 men that came out overnight. They began to stand. The next morning, they stood on what is now called the Lexington Green. What history books don't tell you now, it's actually the churchyard. The Lexington Green is the churchyard of Pastor Jonas Clark's church. And them men gathered themselves there on the Lexington Green, and they faced 800 of the most well-trained, well-equipped soldiers in the world, known as the British Army. Now, just as they had been ordered, these Christians stood their ground without firing until the shot heard round the world was sent from a British soldier. At that point, these Christians resisted. They made a decision to resist. They were outmanned. They were outgunned. You say, preacher, what you're asking us young people to do, it's just hard. Well, you're not the first person that's ever had to do something hard. Now, I'm not going to say it's not tough to live a Christian life as a teenager in these days. I would say that it is. But you're not the first person that's ever had to resist something that was tough. They were outgunned. They were outmanned. In the world's eyes, they were outclassed. But these men made a choice to resist an enemy that was too much for them. When all was said and done, 8 Americans were killed and 9 more were wounded in the battle, but they resisted. They resisted. In the resistance, many, many more British were killed. Say amen right there. I told this story in our church, and I've got a man that's, he's from just off of England. There's an island there called Guernsey. He grew up there. And I was hammering the British through this whole message. It wasn't this particular message, but I was using this story. Afterward, he said, pretty hard on the British today, preacher. In that British accent. I said, I forgot you was here. God bless you, brother. I'll tell you what, it is good. We quote memory verses on Wednesday nights. When he quotes one, it sounds like King James himself. I love it. He stood up one time and quoted one. I said, whoo, maybe you ought to read my scripture every time I preach. Many more of the British were killed, and what happened was it allowed Samuel Adams and John Hancock to escape. As they escaped, word began to spread about the valor and the courage of these Christian patriots. And so what happened is this army now is marching on toward Concord. Word began to spread through the villages about what these men had done, their choice to resist at the peril of their own lives. And so it spread, and what you young people now know as the Minutemen, they started coming out of the woodwork. And they started coming out of their houses, not only in this town, but in the next town. As a matter of fact, the story says that as the British are marching along the road, they can see and hear noises in the woods as these Minutemen are running through the woods to get ahead of them, to get up there and join the rebellion, if you will. They knew something was going on. Word spread, and by the time that the British got to Concord, that number had grown to almost 500. Now, the reason that had happened was because there was a few who resisted. Everybody say the word. A few who resisted. And by the time the British got there, those 500 had gathered together, and the British forces were defeated and forced to retreat. And that battle in itself is really what birthed the American Revolution. But you know what caused it? It wasn't just that battle. There wouldn't have been the 500 that defeated that British army if there hadn't been that few that resisted when they were outgunned and outmanned and outmatched. But they just decided, we're committed to the cause, and we're going to resist as long as we can. You know, that's what we need from you young people. We need you to quit worrying about, don't worry about tomorrow. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. What you need to do is every day say, by the grace of God, I'm going to resist the devil. I'm going to resist my flesh. I'm going to resist the things that might hurt me. And if I win, I win. But if I don't win, maybe I'll make a difference. See, the battle was won because of the few who were willing to resist when it looked like it was an impossible task. Unknown, unlikely heroes against impossible odds and an undefeatable foe. It brought about our country's independence. They were committed to the cause, and they made a difference that's affecting us even today. One pastor later, as word spread, there was one pastor named John Peter Muhlenberg that had been preaching to his church. Now, they wore those long clerical robes, black robes, and they were very conscious about that tradition. They would not take those off. Miss Jill, you can go ahead and come to the piano if you don't care. And he began to preach, and he was preaching out of Ecclesiastes on a time for this and a time for that. And one was a time for war. And he told his congregation, he said, men, there's going to come a time that we may have to fight. At the end of his message, you know what he did? He unzipped that clerical robe, shocked everybody. They don't do that. And when he peeled it off, he had an officer's uniform on. Amen. And he said, now is a time for war. And he walked out, and the men of his church walked out with him. And they joined Washington's army. And listen, when you see the picture of the signing of the treaty, the surrender, that preacher, John Peter Muhlenberg, is one of the generals in that picture on the horse with George Washington. What I'm telling you is there have been some Christians who resisted. And we're enjoying the benefits of it today. And you think, well, preacher, it's not going to make a difference if I resist. Oh, yes, it could. Not only will it in your life, but it may affect others' lives as well. There was a final preacher. I'll tell you this one last story just because I like it. Another preacher heard what had happened here in Lexington, and he got excited, and he and his men eventually got involved in one of those battles, and they were standing, and they were resisting, and you can play whenever you're ready. And as they were shooting, they started running out of wadding. If you know how those guns work, they had to put the powder in, then they'd put a paper wadding in, and then the bullet on top of that. They were running out of wadding, paper. So the preacher went and got the hymn books. And he started ripping up pages out of the hymn books and giving it to them men. Now, in their hymn books, Isaac Watts had written most of their hymns. So the preacher's passing out the papers, and he's saying, give them Watts, boys, give them Watts. And they're shooting them with the hymn book, amen. And they won that battle. You say, boy, where'd he get so fired up? He heard about that few. That few that said, it's impossible, it's hard. They're too big, they're too strong, they're too smart, just like the devil is. But they said, but the cause is worth it. And so we'll resist as long as we can. And their resistance made a difference in the world. And your resistance may make a difference in the world. But it's a decision. It's a decision. You got to identify the two sides. Hey, we have a cause. Brother Cobb preached this morning the cause. The cause is people are lost and they do die and go to hell forever and forever. And we need to have some real Christians who will submit themselves to God and as best we can through the help of the Holy Spirit, resist the devil. Now, nobody's perfect. We don't preach that sinless perfection. But I tell you what, you can sin less through the help of the Holy Spirit. You're not going to be sinless, but you can sin less. And when you get saved, it ought to make a difference. Would you stand? She's playing softly, Summer Coming. Maybe you just ought to come and reaffirm to the Lord about the decisions you've already made, but ask Him and say, Lord, when I get back and the spiritual war starts, will you help me resist? Brother Mike, you want to come and lead us in something? That'd be great.
Who will leave the world side? Who will head, and ask the Lord to help you. Meaning, fierce may be the conflict, strong may be the foe, but the king's own army none can overthrow. Round his standard raging, victory is secure, for his truth unchanging makes the triumph sure. Who is on the Lord's side? That's a real question this morning. You're going to have to resist. If you resist, you're on his side. If you don't, you're on the other side. Let's go ahead and sing in verse number 4.
Fierce may be the conflict, strong may be the foe, but the king's own army none can overthrow. Round his standard raging, victory is secure, for his truth unchanging makes the triumph sure. Joyfully enlisting, by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side, Savior be our shadows vanish, your power will sustain, for it's there that I find refuge, where I'll be safe from harm. No storm can overtake me in the shelter of your arms. In your arms you cradle me and make me secure. In your arms you're showing me your mercy will endure. In your arms you're lifting me above the troubled sea. I'll be safe because I know your arms are holding me. In your
to read these scriptures together. I've never seen that done anywhere else, and I preach a lot of places. Brother Roscoe was talking about how he always gets a portion of scripture that really deals with his life. And I thought, yes, because you pick yours. I was thinking while he was saying that, I always get the most obscure, hard to read portions of the Bible. Every year I just get an odd, you know what I'm talking about. It's all good, but I get that. I get those genealogies and things like that, you know, so-and-so begat so-and-so and so-and-so begat so-and-so. But I want to read you just the first few verses of what I got this year. I got Revelation chapter number 19. And after these things, I heard a great voice and of much people in heaven saying, hallelujah, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments. For he hath judged the great whore which did corrupt the earth with her fornication, and hath avenged the blood of his servants at her hand. And again they said, hallelujah, and her smoke rose up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four beasts fell down and worshiped God that sat on the throne, saying, amen, hallelujah. And a voice came out of the throne saying, praise our God, all ye his servants, and ye that fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and the voice of many waters, and the voice of mighty thundering, saying, hallelujah, for the Lord our God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. Woo, I got a good one this year. Hallelujah. Let's take your Bible and turn with me to the book of Philippians. Philippians, very familiar verse of scripture. I'm going to play just a little bit off. I went to the room last night, and it's bad to eat pizza before you go to bed. I couldn't go to sleep. And man, just mixed emotions, rejoicing over the service and then weeping over the heartache of my daughter. And I woke up this morning to a phone call, and it was my darling daughter on the other end weeping, saying, Daddy, I don't know what to do. I said, baby, we're just going to have to trust God. She said, no, Daddy, I don't know what to do. I don't know, do I call a funeral home? I don't know what to do. I don't know how to tell my children. I'm like, oh boy, my heart just breaking in two. But then come and hear about the people being saved. Man, I don't know how people do this without God. You say, do what, preacher? Life. I don't know how they do it without God. So I'm preaching with a little bit of a heavy heart, but at the same time, a rejoicing heart. They were singing that song a while ago, Brother Mike and them, about the Lord putting his hands around him. I thought about him holding that little 7.5-ounce baby girl. Her name was Olivia Rose. And I just see the Lord having her this morning in the palm of his hand. Woo, hallelujah. There is rejoicing even in suffering. So, but anyway, I want to thank everybody again. I'm really amazed that y'all have allowed me to come this many years. And it's been, Brother Hal don't even call me anymore and ask me if I'll come or if I'm coming. It's just a kind of a given. So I'm going to keep doing it till he does call and say, you're not coming this year. Amen. And thank God for it. But I want to do something before I preach. And I want to thank the Grimes. I don't know how many years it's been. I've never even asked for it. You know, there's always something special in my room or delivered in my door. I got in on Thursday and laid down across the bed and had dozed off, actually, and I heard somebody beating on the door. I thought it was Tony. And I went to the door, and there was nobody there. It was just a basket of goodies and treats and some bottled water sitting outside my door. I appreciate that. Those little things mean a lot. But I want just a couple of kids to stand up. And there's probably many others, and I don't want to leave any out. But Brother Grimes, would you have your children to stand? Would you guys stand? These guys have been here. Where's your daughter at, Sister Barbara? Smiling Stephanie, where's she at? Stand up. And like I just had these guys on my mind. 16, 17 years I've known these kids, and I've watched them grow up. And I want to tell you something that I've noticed. They've never changed. Now, I don't know their personal lives, and I don't know what they are at home, and they may get beatings 3 or 4 times a week. I don't know. Amen. But Stephanie, I've known her since she's a little bitty girl, and it's always, if I smile that much, my face would hurt. But I just want to thank you guys for your faithfulness and tell you I love you. Thank you. Y'all can sit down. I just want to tell you I appreciate you. Amen. The young people that are there, there's never been a year that we said, where are they at? Well, they've got out and they're away from God. And boy, and there they stand. I don't know, boy, my heart's full this morning. I don't know where to preach or just stand here and say glory. Whew, God's good. God's so, so good. And I appreciate His kindness and His mercy. Philippians chapter number 4, if I can pull myself together, we'll preach this morning just for a few minutes. Just a simple little thought. Brother Jesse nailed it. I guess he's gone, but Brother Jesse nailed it last night on that selfie generation. We got back to the hotel and Brother Tony and I were eating last night and he said, man, you wouldn't believe what Sister Jill spoke on to the ladies. All about self. This morning I want to help you with that because that's one of my biggest problems. And now some of you other men, if you'd be honest, you'd say the same thing. The biggest problem I face every day of my life, I shave every morning. It's me. The biggest problem I see, I thought about that young boy with the prop preaching a while ago and he had that mirror. And I thought, boy, it'd be good to preach on what do you see in the mirror? What do you see in the mirror? When I look in the mirror, Brother Cobb, I see self. I look in the mirror sometimes and I get discouraged and I get disgusted. But I found out if I'll just look up, I can get delivered. Amen. Self is my biggest problem, dealing with me. I don't mind dealing with somebody else's sin. I don't mind that at all. I don't mind somebody coming to my office and say, preacher, we got this problem, that problem. I can say, I'll tell you the problem, you're wicked. You just need to get right with God. I don't have a bit of problem telling somebody else that, but I have a problem sometimes looking at me and saying, you're wicked, and you need to get right with God. I don't have a problem listening to a message and hearing the preacher preach and go, boy, boy, he's got him. Son, he's plowing their row. I know who he's preaching to. Or I'll sit there and hear the preacher preach and think, man, I wish so-and-so was here. Come on. Man, if there was ever a message they should have heard, this is it. What about me? Sometimes I hear a preacher preach and I can't even say amen. I'm just like, I can't even get out of old me. I want to crawl under the seat and hide. Find me a hiding place. Amen. But you look at some probably the second most quoted verse of the Bible, maybe the 23rd Psalms, and then probably John 3:16, and then Philippians chapter 4, verse number 13. Watch this. The Bible said, say it with the first word, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. I've heard that a million times since I was growing up in church as a kid. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Now stay with me just for a second. This will be very simple. Because the first word in the verse is I. Sometimes we come under the notion that the emphasis of Philippians 4:13 is I. Because it's the first word, it's the first thing that comes to mind. I, yeah, me, hallelujah, I can do all things. The emphasis in Philippians 4:13 is not I, it's Him. It's not I, it's Him. If we were everyone to be honest this morning, I'm trying to leave you with something that'll help you when you get home to make it back next year still on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. To do that, you're going to have to die to self. To do that, you're going to have to die to self. That's the hardest thing in the world to do. John said, I must decrease. What is that? Die to self that he might increase. Amen. Paul said, till Christ be formed in you. Paul said, I die daily. Killing this old man is one of the hardest things you'll ever do. That's why fasting is one of the hardest things to do. I never eat breakfast. I'm not a breakfast person. Sometimes I don't even eat lunch, but I eat about 10 pounds at supper. I don't eat breakfast, but if I decide to fast, I wake up and everything smells like bacon. I take the dog out in the morning. Bacon. Everything smells like bacon. Why? Because my flesh is fighting a spiritual warfare with my spiritual man. I is a hard thing to deal with. We want to point every other direction and say it's him, it's her, it's them, it's they. No, it's me. And if I'm going to do anything and if I'm going to be anything for God, hey, I got to get my focus off of I. What about me? They hurt my feelings. This is going to sound harsh this morning, and I don't mean for it to. It's not about you. This whole thing, it's not about you. Somebody might say this whole thing was put together for you. No, it wasn't. Some people are having a problem with that. That's our problem. This whole thing was put together for the honor and the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God for those that got saved. I don't know how many, 12, 13, 14, somewhere in there. There's a couple got saved while we was down here last night. Praise the Lord for that. Yeah, that is why we came. But the purpose is not to pump up I or pump up self. The purpose is to give glory and honor to the Lord Jesus Christ. We just read Revelation 19. What were they doing? They were giving praise and honor and glory to Him. They wasn't even just praising Him because they was delivered. They were praising Him because of who He is. Brother Charlie put that very plainly the other night. David said, "Yet will I praise Him." We need to learn to die to self. And the only way to do that, because we are by nature self-centered people, we need to get our minds off self and fix our mind on the Savior. Get our mind off self and on the Savior, and not only on the Savior, but on the supplier, and not only off of self and on the Savior and the supplier, but the sovereignty of God, and not only the sovereignty of God, but the service of God. And then there are sinners who still need God. You want to make it? You got it's in your head. It's in your head. The devil plays mind games. The devil plays mind games. You'll show up and be faithful to church, and the devil say, "Hey, the youth pastor didn't even tell you he appreciated you. He didn't even shake your hand, tell you he is glad you is here." The devil get in your head and tell you all kind of stuff. The devil get in your head and say, "Hey, the pastor don't like you." Am I right about it? He'll get you to thinking about self and what's fair to me. Hey, listen, if you'll take this simple little formula this morning, these simple four little words, and engrave them in your mind, write them down in your Bible, it'll help you to live for God. It'll help you to live for God. Number one, get your mind off self and get your mind on the Savior. Paul said in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 9, "But we see Jesus." It's all in what you see. I could have got up this morning bitter and mad. I could have got up with nothing in my mind but a dead little baby. And I could have got mad and said, "God, what have I done? What did my daughter do? They serve you. They've given you all their lives, God, to worship you and to serve you. They've lived good, clean lives." But I had to get up instead of my mind on a dead baby. I had to get on my mind a living Savior this morning. We've got to see Jesus. We've got to see Jesus. I remember a little poem that I heard years ago when I was a kid. It was about a cat that went to London, and it said, kitty cat, where have you been?" She said, "I've been to London to see the Queen." Kitty cat, what did you see there?" She said, "I spied a mouse run under her chair." You say, "I don't get it." There she is in the splendor of Buckingham Palace. There she is in the presence of the crown jewels and the Queen, and what does she see? A rat. In the words of Flip Wilson, it'll tell your age by the one who's laughing. Flip Wilson said, "What you see is what you get." How many of y'all remember? Was that Flip or Geraldine, his girl part? Amen. What you see is what you get. Hey, you know what you got out of this thing this weekend? What you came looking for. You got out of this thing this weekend what you came looking for. I don't know about you, but I come looking for Him more about Jesus. More, I come looking for Him. I come looking for the power of God. I come looking for the people of God. I come looking for the praise of God. Hey, by the way, I got what I came for. How about you? I've noticed some, bless your heart, you've sat there with an attitude the whole time. The whole week you hadn't smiled. You hadn't come to the altar. It's because what you're looking at. You can't look at Jesus and have an attitude. You know why? Because you're going to be just like Pilate. Huh, I find no fault in this man. I don't see nothing but good when I look at him. Amen. We're going to have to get our minds off self and get our minds on the Savior. Jesus said, without me, ye can do nothing. Amen. In other words, by yourself, you know what you are? Nobody. Boy, that's not this world's theology, is it? Joel Osteen would never tell you that. Jesus said, without me, ye can do nothing. But with him, I can do what? All things. So the focus on the scripture is not the I, it's the him. It's Jesus Christ. We need to recognize, get our eyes off of self and on the Savior. We need to get our eyes off of self and on the supplier. Philippians chapter 4 and verse number 19, he said, but my God shall supply all your needs by his riches in glory. I'm going to live this when I get home. Let him help you and give you what you need. I've got to go home and stand over a little grave. And watch my daughter. One of my men, Brother David Connell, his mother died this morning about 4 o'clock. Probably Monday, I'll have to stand over her grave. That's amazing. One that was born dead. One that died in old age. It's just amazing. It's just amazing to me. A grave this big and a grave that big. To do that by myself, to stand there and watch my baby girl cry, to stand there and watch my little grandbabies, 7, 5, and 3, who don't understand what's going on. Man, I can't do that by myself. I'm going to have to say, Lord, you're going to have to supply me, and you're going to have to help me. If you're going to resist the devil, like Brother Tony talked about, man, what a message. Man, you've heard some of the greatest preaching this week. It's been unreal. If you're going to resist the devil, you're going to have to ask the Lord Jesus Christ to give you what you need. You know what? You're no match for sin, and you're no match for Satan. Amen. No match whatsoever. These TV preachers kill me. They kill me. I command thee, Lucifer. Yeah, who are you? That's a chihuahua barking at a freight train. Yeah. I command thee, Lucifer. Try that. He'll eat you alive. Amen. That's like that 500-pound lion. A 500-pound lion. I read a story here a few weeks ago about a guy who was riding his Harley past the zoo in Washington, D.C. And as he was passing through, he saw a little girl leaning into the lion cage. And just as he was riding by, the lion reached out with his big paw and drug the little girl in the lion cage. The guy jumped off his Harley and ran over there, and just out of instinct, he just reached in and punched the lion right in the nose, and it startled the lion enough, it turned the little girl loose. And the mother picked up the little girl, and she was rejoicing, oh, thank you, and everybody was just amazed. And this lady came over and said, sir, that's the most amazing thing I've ever seen. He said, oh, it wasn't nothing. He said, anybody? No, she said, no, you don't understand. She said, I'm a journalist. I work for the Washington Post. Your story will be on the front page tomorrow. She said, by the way, what do you do for a living? He said, well, ma'am, I'm a United States Marine. She said, what is your political affiliation? He said, well, ma'am, if you have to know, I'm a Republican. Sure enough, the next day he looked at the front page news of the Washington Post, and it said, United States Marine assaults African immigrant and steals his lunch. I had absolutely nothing to do with the message. I got an excuse like Tony. That was that other me up there. I just said lion, and it made me think of it. If we're going to defeat that 500-pound lion, we're going to need somebody. I remember when we was kids in Sunday school and we'd color and draw pictures. I remember learning about Samson as a 5 and 6 year old little boy. And I pictured Samson like the great Tony Atlas of years ago and the great bodybuilders. I can't think of nobody current. Vin Diesel, some of them guys, them big old dudes, them big old arms. I pictured Samson, but I don't think Samson was like that, Brother Cobb. I think he's just a normal everyday man whom the power of God rested on. They couldn't say he's defeating these armies because of his strength. They couldn't say he can whoop us with a jawbone because of the mighty man that he is. No, they were amazed that he was just a normal man, but he had the supply of God in his life. Hey, we can beat the devil at his game with Jesus as our helper. But we're going to have to trust him. We're going to have to trust him. There's some things coming your way that you cannot resist on your own. But if you'll take the supply from heaven, you can resist that. We're going to have to get our mind off of I and get our mind on the Savior. We're going to have to get our mind off of I and get our mind on the supplier. We're going to have to get our mind off of I and get our mind on the sovereignty of God. You say, what's that mean? Well, the book of Acts, chapter number 2, said it like this. He's both Lord and Christ. He's both Lord and Christ. Are y'all okay? Christ is Savior. Lord is sovereign. That means he's in control. What I'm saying, young people, is you're going to have to yield over your life into his control. You're going to have to submit yourself unto his authority. There's times that I do things that my flesh don't want to do, but I do it because he said do it. I had to witness to a lady on a plane the other day. And buddy, I knew it. When I sat down, my heart started going, y'all know, anybody know what I'm talking about? And the Holy Ghost said, you need to talk to her. And I said, I'll wait till we take off. And I had my Bible laying on the tray table. And she looks over to me out of the blue. She said, excuse me, are you a preacher? I started to say, no, I'm an atheist, and I'm trying to disprove this book right here. She said, are you a preacher? And I said, yes, ma'am, I am. She was like the lady at the beauty shop. I got questions.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. I got questions. By the time that plane landed, that lady was weeping and crying and rejoicing. Woo! You know what that was? That was allowing him to be Lord and obeying him. There's times that you're going to have to go against your flesh. There's going to be many times you're going to have to go against your flesh and do it because, like your mom and daddy said, because he said so. I do a lot of things as a Christian, I'll be honest with you, I really don't want to do, but God said so. Brother Tony and I was in a hotel a while back. We were in Pennsylvania, and there was a big bike rally. They were celebrating 9/11 when the plane crashed in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, and all them bikers was staying in our hotel, and we went down for breakfast, and I mean, you couldn't move. It was a Hampton Inn. Everybody was down there getting biscuits and gravy. I mean, it was tight, tight, tight. Tony said, man, I got to do something. I said, what? He said, the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart and told me to have prayer with these people. I said, I think I heard him tell you too. I said, I'm going to go over and get me a biscuit. You go ahead. I'm a chicken, man. And my best friend stood there and said, ladies and gentlemen, big old tears started rolling down his face. He said, can I have your attention? Everybody looked up. He said, I know why you're here. And I know why what y'all are doing. He said, I think it'd be good if we just bowed our head and thank God. Pray for those families, for those family members that went down on that plane. Did you know not one biker in the room objected? Tears started rolling down their face. Yes, sir. I heard some amen brothers.
Yeah.
And we were able, well, excuse me, he was able to bow right there in front of all them people and lead them in prayer. I thought, what a thing, man. Buddy, he didn't do that because he wanted to do that. I know Tony. He didn't do that because he did that because the Holy Spirit told him to, and then the Holy Spirit gave him what he needed to do it. Isn't that amazing? You know what it's all about? It's all about who's in charge in your life. There's a throne in your heart. Who's sitting on it? I've heard some people preach you can't truly be saved if Jesus isn't Lord of your life. Bull-long-y. I know people who play musical chairs with that throne. It needs to be Jesus on that throne and not you on that throne. Let him be sovereign in your life. Let him. He wants to be Lord of your life. Listen, he don't just want to ride in the ship. He wants to be the captain. Amen. Amen. We need to get our eye off of self and on the Savior. We need to get our eye off of self and on the supplier. We need to get our eye off of self and on the sovereignty of God. We need to get our eye off of self and on the service of God. Get busy. Do something for God. You say, what can I do, preacher? Ask your pastor. I guarantee there's something you can do. Take your Bible to school. There's small things. Pray over your lunch in front of your classmates. Well, prayer's not allowed in school. They cannot stop you from praying. You don't have to pray out loud. If you bow your head before you eat, they know what you're doing. If you're not thankful for your food, at least do it for a testimony to them. Amen. Start doing something for God. I've got teenagers working bus routes. I've got three sisters that started out on the bus when Stephanie was there. They were just little bitty girls. Now they've got a bus route of their own. I've got teenage boys preaching on bus routes every Sunday. They hear a sermon before they ever get to the church. They pick up that last kid and they cut that little preacher boy loose and he starts preaching. There's something you can do for God. And it don't involve Xbox. Amen. Why don't you witness on Facebook?
Amen. Come on. Amen.
Don't put a selfie on there. Put a hemi on there. Amen. Amen. Get on Facebook and talk about how many people got saved. Get on Facebook and talk about what the Lord did in your heart and your life this weekend. Get your mind off of yourself and on the service of God. What can I do to make a difference? I guarantee you there's somebody out there you can reach that I can't. Guaranteed. Get your eye off of self and on the Savior. Eye off of self and on the supplier, on the sovereignty of God, on the service of God. Lastly, and I'm done, get your eye off of self and on the sinners who still need God. Romans chapter number 1, verse 14, Paul said, I am a debtor. I am a debtor. I owe a debt. I owe a debt. Somebody said, why would you leave your daughter who is having trouble in her pregnancy and fly all the way up here in this bitter? I didn't come up here because I wanted to. I'm excited about the meeting. It's nice at my house. I can walk to my truck without getting snow in my socks. I come here because I owe a debt. I owe a debt to a God who saved me from a life of sin and an eternity in hell to tell another sinner where they can get the same thing I got. You got saved this weekend? You need to go tell somebody. You say, well, I don't know how to witness. That lady at the well didn't either. That lady at the well didn't either. The Bible says she got so excited she left her water pot. Why? Because she left with a well. And she ran back to town. Here's what she did. Come see a man told me all things ever I did is not this to Christ. She witnessed. Witnessed is not I'm against some of these soul-winning clinic. You know why you have to teach people to witness about God? Because there ain't no God in them. You get full of God, you'll tell somebody. Amen. That Ed McMahon check comes, the publisher's clearinghouse, he's dead. But anyway, that check comes to my house. I saw on TV the other day, $5,000 a week for the rest of your life and the rest of your children's life. I get that. I'm calling Brother Howe. You ain't going to believe this. I'm calling somebody. Why? Because a good thing happened to me. Man, Jesus Christ came into my heart. Forgave me of every sin I ever committed. Got it covered, past, present, and future. Hallelujah, man. Money can't buy that. Ed McMahon couldn't put a down payment on it. If it's really all that good, wouldn't we share it with somebody? Tell somebody, say, hey, I don't understand it all, but I'm going to heaven when I die. Amen. Let's work on keeping our eye off of self and on the Savior. Put the emphasis on Him instead of us. Put the emphasis on others. Somebody once said years ago, I wrote this little acronym down, J-O-Y, joy. Jesus, others, and then you. Jesus said, take no thought for your life, what you'll put on, what you'll eat. Lay not up for yourself treasures on earth where moths and rust and thieves come in and corrupt, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. Man, let's get our mind on the things of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And that's one of the hardest things to do in this age and in this world in which we live. I know preachers that can't get their mind on God because they're so caught up in Fox News.
Yep. That's right. Yep. That's the truth, bro.
That's all they talk about.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
That's all I hear. I'm like, shut up, man. I can only take so much of Bill O'Reilly and Glenn Beck and all that junk. Boy, I got some under somebody's skin right there.
Yeah.
Amen. Read your Bible, man.
Amen.
What are we going to do? What are we going to read? Proverbs chapter 3, 5, and 6. Man, trust the Lord. That bunch of have you so angry and bitter and hateful. Let's get our minds on Him. I know somebody, that's all they think about. What's going on? What's going on? What's going on? Man, let's get our mind on God. The devil uses these worldly things, we call them worldly, to distract these kids. He's got things to distract us too.
That's right.
Get your mind's heart centered on something else. I hit a nerve right there. Here a few months ago, my wife asked me, she said, what's the matter with you? I said, ain't nothing matter with me. She said, yeah, there is. She said, you've been mad for a month. And it finally dawned on me, I need to change my radio station. I mean, keep up with what's going on, but man, don't live and breathe and eat that stuff. That's not in my notes. I don't know who that's for. Maybe you've been a little grumpy and mean here lately. Hallelujah. That's that little voice, yeah. Let's get our minds on Him. Let's get our minds on Him. You think about Him. You read about Him. You study on Him. You won't do nothing but love Him. Amen. If we'll keep our minds on Him and off of self, we'll make it back here next year. We'll still be excited and we'll still be serving God. Let's stand to our feet this morning. Maybe you'd just like to get in the altar this morning before we go. Just ask the Lord to help you. Place number one in your life. Sister Jill, if you'd just play, Brother Mike, if you come get us a song. Let's just mind the Lord this morning. If Jesus tarries, I want to come back next year. And I want to be the same, if not a better Christian next year than I was this year. It ought to be a progression. We ought to be growing. But man, without Him, remember what He said? You can do nothing. So let's mind the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, as we come to you again this morning, Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name for a good meeting. Lord, if you hadn't have shown up, there wouldn't have been much to this. We'd have heard some good singing. We'd have had some good fellowship. But Lord, nothing lasting would have taken place. But Lord, because of your presence and because of your power, eternal things happened this week. And God, we thank you for that. Lord, thank you for being with my family while I'm away. God, watch over them till I get there. And then Lord, watch over us all. Father, help these teenagers to live for you, to take a stand for you, and to do right. Lord, be with these pastors and these youth pastors as they try to lead. God, I pray you help keep them straight. Help us to all keep our eyes on you. Father, have your way in this altar call, and we'll thank you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Let's go ahead and sing a couple stanzas of the Haven of Rest.
My soul is
Sempronius Baptist Church, and our pastor is Pastor Dennis Grimes.
Amen. Hi, my name is Jacob Woods, and we are from Maranatha Bible Church in Constable, New York, and our pastor is Arthur Prevey.
We're First Baptist Church of Black River, and our pastor is Pastor Jack Young.
Victory Baptist Church, Pastor Patrick Burke.
Where is it?
Victory Baptist Church.
Hold it over. Come on over here. Let me see it. Hold it up.
Okay.
Hold it down. Whoops. There we go. All right. Hold it down a little bit. You're taller than he is. There we go. Okay, go ahead. You're next.
We're Old Time Baptist Church, and our pastor is Pastor Luke Adano.
I'm Pastor Beam from Grace Baptist Church in Mendina, New York, and every time we tried to have Banner Day in preparation for Youth Ablaze, we got snowed out, so we tried something different this year. Go ahead.
GBC.
Amen.
That's good. I like that. Okay, folks. Open up.
I'm from Watertown Baptist Temple. My pastor is Dewey Stewart.
There we go. What's it say? Is that King James, Dewey? Okay, go ahead. The only reason we're doing it is because these two girls, that's all.
We're the only ones left. Our church went home. But we're from Shalom Baptist Church in North Tonawanda. Yay!
Who's taking pictures?
Nobody.
Oh, man. Who's taking pictures? You got it? Okay. Then, why don't you step back over here and take a full picture, Chad. And of course, Charlotte Bible Baptist Church, our banner is our church right now. Amen. Hold them up. Amen. There we go. Tell us when we're done. You're good. Okay. Super. Now you can go home.
Thank you.
Sorry. You got it.